Next on Worcester News Tonight, a young life lost after a drowning at Bell Pond last week. We hear from a friend of the victim tonight. Plus, World Cup madness hits Worcester as dozens gather outside City Hall to view the semifinal match. Tonight, we're hearing from the best friend of the boy who drowned in Worcester's Bell Pond. Good evening, I'm Anna Botari. 13-year-old Omari Hector was found nearly 70 feet from the shore and later died at a local hospital last Wednesday. His friends are remembering him as an outgoing and cheerful teenager. Our Cam Jandro has the story.
Tommy Vaness lost his best friend last week.
Whenever we hung out, he was always happy. And he was just always happy. He would always make people laugh.
13-year-old Omari Hector slipped under the water on the 4th of July in Worcester's Bell Pond. He was rushed to a local hospital where he died. It's why Vaness and his father Dennis started a fundraiser for Omari's funeral services.
His family needed the support, and they needed to get money.
Tommy came to me, and obviously very, very upset. We sat down, we talked about it, collaborated, and wanted to find a way to give back.
The two became friends at Worcester's Forest Grove Middle School. Vaness says the last week has been difficult without Omari.
Really hard for everyone to cope with this happening. So all of our friends are getting together right now, getting together and talking to each other, and we're all trying to get through this together.
Now the GoFundMe page is titled Rally for Omari. Vaness says the goal is to raise $15,000 to pay for Omari's funeral services. Anna.
Thanks, Kim. Tonight we're hearing from the cousin of the Millbury man who drowned last week. Ronnie Marlowe was with his cousin Michael when the incident happened and says he did everything he could to try and save him. Our Chandler Walsh has more on the tragedy the family's experiencing.
Still beside myself. I still don't believe it, you know. Keep looking over, like waiting for him to pop his head out of the water.
Ronnie Marlowe holds his cousin's baseball hat in disbelief he's gone. Michael Boyd drowned Friday while the two searched for a missing tackle box on Dorothy Pond in Millbury. Marlowe says Boyd put on a snorkeling mask and went into the water.
He went down and he breathed in water and just panicked, I guess, and went straight down.
Marlowe has had multiple ear surgeries and is partially deaf, but it didn't stop him from trying to save his cousin.
I didn't see him, you know, so it was right after the thunderstorm. So I guess the current was real bad anyways. I just dove it. I kept swimming.
Marlowe was released from the hospital Tuesday after suffering a seizure and damage to his ears. He thanked first responders for their efforts trying to save his cousin. Millbury Police Chief Donald DeSourcy was one of the first on scene and got right into the water.
We knew time was of the essence. We really didn't have much. And so the officers, we just got in.
The two cousins grew up in the same apartment complex and did everything together. As adults, they spent time together outdoors, including many fishing trips on Dorothy Pond, right next to Marlowe's home. Marlowe says his cousin was a wonderful person with a great personality.
Loving husband, great guy, you know, good to hang out with.
That was our Chandler Walsh reporting. Leicester is considering a proposal which would bring a cultivation and research-based marijuana facility to the town. Assistant to the town administrator Kristen Forsberg says the center, Integrated Genetics and Biopharma Research, would be located on Route 9 at the Everlast Nursery property. It would not be accessible to the public. They would grow plants up to a certain point, then transport them to another location. She says they would conduct research creating strains which have little to no THC and can be alternatives to pharmaceuticals.
So it's interesting because it's actually kind of come full circle. We started with medical in Massachusetts, then we went to recreational. Now we have a cutting edge firm that's coming out and is doing some really innovative things with new strains and really trying to help like kids and people that have medical conditions. So we're really excited that this type of industry is coming to town.
A community outreach meeting was held tonight. Forsberg says the next step is for the town administrator to negotiate a host community agreement with the firm. A decorated member of the Pakistani Air Force was laid to rest today at Worcester's Hope Cemetery. Family and friends gathered tonight to remember the Wing Commander Yusuf Ali. He fought in two wars in the Pakistani Air Force and was awarded the Star of Daring after helping to capture an enemy aircraft in the 1960s. When he retired in the 90s, he came to Central Massachusetts, which has become a second home to him.
And he spent his final days in this country. He wished to be buried here. He had the option of going back to Pakistan and be buried with full military honors, but he chose to be buried here in his adopted land. Very nicely, the Pakistan Air Force sent two colonels to be at his burial and present honors there. So.
Mayor Joseph Petty also presented Yusuf Ali's family with the key to the city. A federal judge dismisses two lawsuits against the former head of the Massachusetts State Police. The lawsuits were filed by two state troopers who allege they were ordered to change the arrest report of a judge's daughter. The judge says troopers Ryan Scavior and Allie Ray's allegations against former state police superintendent Richard McEwen and Major Susan Anderson do not meet the proper standard under federal law. The troopers claim they were ordered to help illegally change the arrest report of Allie Bebo, the daughter of Dudley District Court Judge Timothy Bebo. The troopers still have cases in state court. Volunteers from a Central Massachusetts mission are working in Haiti as the country experiences violent protests. They grounded most flights in the island nation. Despite all the disruption, the nonprofit's president says everyone is doing well. Our Rosalind Flaherty has the story.
After days of violent protests in Haiti, Scott Long says things are starting to calm down. He's the president of a nonprofit in Hubbardston called Mission E4 and is on a mission trip in Haiti. Haiti's government announced an increase in gasoline prices last week, which sparked the protests. The U.S. Embassy in the country's capital is warning U.S. citizens to shelter in place.
Along with the roadblocks, I mean, we're burning tires in the streets and, you know, bringing vehicles to block the road and rocks and all kinds of things to keep people from passing.
Long has been working in the country for almost 20 years and says he isn't afraid for his safety.
I've kind of been through a few rounds of this. I certainly understand, you know, people being here as new people, it's definitely a nervous experience.
His son, Taryn, is traveling to Haiti this week with 25 other mission members to work on building a new school.
Any of the people that I was talking to on the ground, they were encouraged to shelter in place during the protests, but none of them ever felt that they were trapped in any way or that they were in danger.
Long says he had a carpenter from Princeton arrive Monday afternoon with no problems, but the State Department is still warning U.S. citizens to exercise extreme caution. Rosalind Flaherty, Worcester News Tonight.
CNBC has a list of the most expensive places to live in this country, and it includes several New England states. Massachusetts is number 3, topped only by California and Hawaii. Connecticut comes in at number 8, and Rhode Island is 9th on the list. CNBC used average home and food prices, monthly energy bills, and health costs to come up with the rankings. Keeping kids off the streets. Several summer programs in Worcester offer a safe place for students to go during the workday, where they can participate in different activities and continue to learn throughout the summer months. Our Brittany Schaefer explains.
It's the sounds you can hear all year long at the Worcester Boys and Girls Club. In the summertime, the club sees 600 children every day.
We have everything from boxing to basketball to swimming, but we also have the arts, including dance and music. In addition, we address summertime learning loss by doing a lot of literacy programs.
Their goal is to keep city children ages 5 to 18 busy during the summer months. Executive Director Liz Hamilton says their program helps keep crime down during the busiest months for Worcester Police.
When the club had to close because we were moving from Ionic Ave to here in Main South, we actually saw an increase in crime. And since we've been back here in Main South, there's been a decrease in crime. So I know it's important. It's the most critical time of the year.
And the Worcester Police Department say programs like these work.
It's a big help because kids have a lot of free time. And inevitably, when kids get bored, sometimes they're going to do things that we don't want them doing and their parents don't want them doing. So having productive activities, organized activities for them to channel their energy into is a great thing, and it keeps kids out of trouble.
The department runs 6 different youth programs during the summer, including basketball games. Lieutenant Sean Murtha says it's important for officers and children to bond.
It's great when they can see us as people or coaches and not just authority figures. So it's a way to get to know kids better and on a different level than you would just by being a street cop.
Hamilton says with the right support, every child can succeed.
All kids are at risk if they don't have the resources and support they need to grow. We're really helping our kids have a great future.
The Worcester Police Department's basketball program runs twice a week. Murtha says it's a popular one with more than 300 kids involved. Brittany Schaefer, Worcester News Tonight.
Dozens of soccer fans congregated in downtown Worcester Tuesday to watch the World Cup semifinal game between France and Belgium. A large screen was set up just outside City Hall as viewers watched from the Worcester Common Oval. A large group of Belgium fans sat under a tent while waving the country's flag proud, although it was France who came out on top with the 1-0 score. Chick-fil-A is giving away free sandwiches today, but there's a catch. You have to dress up like a cow to receive one. July 10th marks the chain's annual Cow Appreciation Day. The celebration is part of the restaurant's long-standing advertising campaign, encouraging people to skip burgers and instead eat more chicken. In Worcester, dozens dressed up like the animal to receive their free entree.
Fantastic. Families coming together, doing the spots, doing the ears, doing the noses. It's been great.
This is the 14th year Chick-fil-A hosted the event.